own commercial. Well, everybody says it's time to start, so I'm starting. Sound good? Yay! Everybody get a bulletin? If you didn't raise your hand, Sharon will get you one. Bulletins! Okay. Well, today we have our potluck and communion. Awesome. And tonight, no service because we have the potluck and we usually go late and it's hard to go back and forth. So no service tonight. Wednesday night, we're back on schedule, 7 o'clock. Wednesday night, Friday youth. Woohoo! Youth, where are you, youth? Hello. Anyway, they're upstairs helping. Oh, well. Okay, so Friday night, youth. Saturday, next Sunday, back here. I don't have to say hi to Mama. Hi, Mama. I'm like, hi, Mama, when she's home watching. But she's here. Hi, Mom. Mom, tomorrow, right, Sharon? Turns 93. So make sure everybody says happy birthday to Mom today during the potluck. It's going to be awesome. And then next Sunday, Sunday night, we will be having services next Sunday night because we don't have potluck and Pastor has his service ready to go. I tell you to go get stuff after church because Joy always has the window open and we sell stuff there. Joy's always making something for breakfast, but she doesn't do it on potluck Sunday because we're just going to go eat right afterwards. But this month, Joy decided, she was led from the Lord, that this month any money that comes in is going to go towards the building fund. Usually she gives it to the youth or children's church, but the Lord put on her heart to do building fund this month. Who knows what next month to do? So right now, all the money that you buy anything from Joy in the kitchen next week might be burritos, might not. We're waiting on certain things, but she pre-orders ahead of time if you want stuff from her, and that way you could pay, and that money will go into the building fund, which is awesome. And Cheryl's not here right now or today, but we started a new ministry, Lending Hands, and what that is Cheryl has an upstairs room with all stuff in it that people give, and some of the stuff up there is brand new. Plus, she gives away food. And bags, we have bags that we made up for the homeless that we give out. It's really awesome. And if anybody wants to grab an envelope and put $10 towards that, it goes in. We have money in my office that we put in there, and that's what we buy all the supplies with. So we got a lot going on right now. So not today, no, but they can make appointments, though, and come in during the week with Cheryl. Oh, the cards. I need a card. I want to show everybody. They're out on the thing. Could somebody get me a business card out there? So this is really reaching out to the community. You know, both Loveland and Berthoud, and we're going to shoot for Longmont here. Those guys in the back row are going to help us with the Longmont stuff. But instead of calling the church all the time, Cheryl says, well, maybe I should get some cards made. And Pastor came up with this brilliant idea. He wanted to change the old church cards anyway because they were kind of bleh, you know. So he wanted something new. We've had them, what, for almost 30 years now. So it's time for new, right? Update things. And so anyway, we're going to, Pastor worked on it a couple of weeks ago and him and Cheryl decided that they're going to make one card for two purposes, business card, and that way you get it. I just need one up here right fast. So on one side is BFC, and it has mine and Pastor's church number and us on it and the address and stuff. And the other side is Cheryl's ministry of laying hands. What's it called? Lending Hands. Lending Hands on the other side. So take one and take a couple if you want and give them away, you know, to people anywhere, you know. And it has both her number for the giving aways and the food ministry and the church number to get a hold of Pastor and I. So they're pretty awesome. Take one, enjoy it. And anyway, so a lot's going on here at BFC. Hallelujah. We're having a great time. And we also have online, I don't know what that thing is, but I don't go online, can you tell? I barely know how to use my phone, and it's smarter than me, according to the people that made it. But anyway, so go ahead and just, you know, join us and join us online. If you can't make it here, we'd love for you to watch. And if you need anything, please give us a call. The number's up on the screen, and we'd love talking with you. Sharon.
All right, it's my turn. Yay. So we're going to take up today's offering. Yay. An awesome time. Because who are we giving to? Yes. Amen. And you know, a lot of people don't think of it that way, and that's why they have a hard time with giving in the offering, is because, you know, oh, I got to give again. No, you get to give again, you know, because it's a blessing. God blesses us for everything that we give, whether we give it into the church or whether we give it to someone else. And I thought about this today, because Brett, when he done the offering, when I did the service on a Wednesday, or Sunday, he said his favorite scripture is Luke 6:38, give and it shall be given you, pressed down, shaken together, running over shall men give unto your bosom, but with what measure you meet, it will be measured back to you. So I was thinking about this, and I was sitting at my kitchen table, and Pastor Marianne gave me these little blocks, and one of them is believe, one is faith, and then I got one for a Christmas present here at the church thing, and it says pray, and then I put on the other side of that, I put hope, and then the last one is peace. So going back here to Brett, is him and his wife are so blessed because they are givers. They give and they keep on giving. They're like the ever ready bunny. I mean, they're always ready to give to someone that needs it. You know, when somebody puts God puts it on their heart, I mean, it might be even 5 seconds and they're giving them something. Or they're always helping the, you know, people here at the church. They are so blessed. They're blessed when they come in. They're blessed when they go out. So I was sitting there at the table, and I was looking at these blocks this morning, and I said, believe. Do we really believe what God says? Because God says in Malachi chapter 3, 10 through 11, he says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse. And then he says, that I might open the windows of heaven over you. So if we're tithers, then he opens the windows of heaven over us to bless us, to pour out what we need. So he will open those windows because he knows what we have need of. And he will, it also says in verse 11, he will rebuke the devourer. He will rebuke our enemy. Those circumstances that arise to take our finances, or to take our emotions, our thoughts, or our sickness, or, you know, when those things come against us, he rebukes them for us because we are tithers. First of all, first and foremost, we need to be tithers, and then he works for us because we give to him. And then the next one was faith. And Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. And so you give by faith, and you give by knowing. Philippians 4:19 says that all my needs are met according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. So you know that you know, and you do it by faith. You give by faith. And then pray. You talk to God. You pray. prayer is just talking and fellowshipping with our Lord. You know, you tell him what's on your heart. Tell him what you have need of. Yes, Father, I'm afraid. I'm scared that this fire is going to come over the ridge. But I stand knowing that you're going to protect us. You're going to put the angels in charge of us. So I know that my needs are met according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And then there's hope. Hope is Hebrews 6:19. Hope, you take hope and it's an anchor. Like you throw that anchor out into the ship and it stops. You know, you don't hope, or you don't think, oh, maybe it'll stop. No, you hope it will, you know. But, you know, you hope that it's coming to pass, everything, because he knows what you have need of. And so you put the anchor down and you say, I know that my needs are met. I know that he provides for me. And therefore comes peace, because when you know that you know that you know he takes care of you, then you stay in peace. And you thank the Lord that no matter what, you can stay in peace and knowing that all things are done according to his plans, according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus for us. Right? Amen. All right, so then we're going to lift our offering and we're going to pray. Father, thank you for this day. We thank you, Father God, for all of our needs being met. And as we honor you with our offering, with our substance, Father God, we just say you are blessed. And we lift you on high. You are the most holy God. And we honor you. And we thank you, Father, for providing for us in Jesus' name. Amen. And then I just wanted to add one more thing. My brother Cliff's birthday is Saturday. Yay! So that's another April birthday. So everybody stand up and say hello, hello, and how are you today? Give him a big hug.
Good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Well, we got all the birthdays taken care of. Don't forget it's Darlene's birthday today, too.
Where is she? There she is.
So I think first, before we sing our praise and worship, we need to sing happy birthday to Darlene and Mama. What do you think?
And Cliffy now.
And Cliffy, that's right. And David, if he was here.
And and David if he was here.
And Sharon's is coming up, and Karen's is coming up, and oh my gosh.
Oh my goodness.
And Brett's coming up.
Yeah, Brett's coming up.
Mine's December.
Oh my gosh.
Whee!
And yeah, Jaden. Oh, okay. We better sing happy birthday to everybody.
Happy birthday
to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, all April birthdays. Happy birthday to you. God's good.
Woo-hoo. Come on.
All the time. But sometimes we need a reminder, right?
Amen.
I needed a reminder, you know? So I'm going to tell you a little personal story because I believe it's going to help somebody here. I've been struggling with some things. And I was starting to lose a little bit of faith, having a little bit of doubt. But God's good, and he was very patient with me. And the other day, Marianne and I were Grubhubbing, right? And something came up that came on my heart that I didn't feel somebody was going to do something. I just didn't feel that they should do it. So I looked at Marianne, and I said, let's just pray. Let's just pray on it. Now I'm telling my pastor to pray. You know.
What's wrong with this picture? No.
So we prayed on it, and I looked at her, and I said, real soon the phone's going to ring, and that person's going to tell you they're not doing it. Not even 20 minutes later, the phone rang, and that person didn't do what they were going to do. Now, I've had a doctor tell me I need to have something done, and I've been struggling with it. So the other night I sat down, and I tried to figure out, why am I struggling with this? I know I have faith. I know that God can heal me. He's healed me before over a lot worse things. But I still was struggling because I think we're human and we all do. So I realized, number one, this is no surprise to anybody that knows me, I'm a planner. And I wouldn't go to the ER when this was hurting me because it wasn't planned. I mean, if I'm going to have this procedure done, then I'm going to plan it, right? I'm going to make sure I know when it's going to be done. I'm going to rearrange my house. Ask Chloe. I got it all planned out here. And so it's going on my time, which is pretty silly, right? And Marianne asked me one day, so is it more important for you to be in pain or for you to do what you're supposed, you know, obligated to do? Because I also have told some people I'd do some things, and I didn't want to let them down. And my answer was, it's more important to do the things I need to do. Not for me, not for my health. So I went to bed, and I said, okay, Lord, I'm done. I'm tired of hurting. I'm tired of feeling this way, and I'm tired of worrying. You told me not to, it's yours. It's all yours. Finances are rough. I don't know how I'm going to do this without finances. I can't take a couple weeks off. So I went to bed. Slept pretty good for the first time in a long time. Got up the next morning. And I had sent some money to somebody, and it didn't go through, so I thought maybe it came back. So first thing I did was check my bank account. Well, guess what? There was an extra $1,000 in my bank account. I thought, it's a scam. Got to be a scam. Not going to spend that money. So I did some investigating, and it came from Social Security. It was a one-time payment, no explanation. God is good. That's right. That's right. Don't doubt. I know. It's so easy. It's so easy. But, you know, I don't know how many more times he can smack me across the face and say, what else do you need?
Come on.
So I'm going to do what I need to do, whatever that may be. And I'm hoping that everybody here got a little bit more faith today because he's here. Amen. And all you got to do is ask. Amen.
Amen. Woo! Glory. Glory, glory.
You guys ready to lift your hearts to Him?
Yes.
You believe He's there?
Yes.
You believe He hears you?
Yes.
You believe He's responding?
Woo! Amen.
Put that smile on your face. Go ahead and stand up if you want. And just get ready to worship Him.
Woo!
He is worthy.
Good God Almighty, I know You'll find me praising Your name no matter what comes. I can't count the times I've called Your name some broken night. You showed up and patched me up like You do every time I get amnesia. I forget that You keep coming round. Ain't no way You'll ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I know You'll find me praising Your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without Your mercy. So I keep praising Your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is He good?
He's good.
Tell me, is He God?
He's God.
He is good God Almighty. You say Your love goes on forever, that Your mercy never stops. Why would I assume You'd be somebody that You're not, like sun in the morning? I know You're gonna be there every day. What on earth would make me be afraid? Good God Almighty, I know You'll find me praising Your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without Your mercy. So I keep praising Your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is He good?
He's good.
Tell me, is He God?
He's God.
He is good God Almighty. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. Good God Almighty, I know You'll find me praising Your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without Your mercy. So I keep praising Your name at the top of my lungs. Let me hear it. Tell me, is He good?
He's good.
Tell me, is He God?
He's God.
He is good God Almighty. Praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime, praise Him when the sun goes down. Love Him in the morning, love Him in the noontime, love Him when the sun goes down.
Thank you.
never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide. I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. 'Cause you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Circumstances and pain and yada, yada, yada. And you know, it's just not true. He can't give us what he doesn't have. Okay, I'm going to talk to these guys over here. You guys get caught up with me. He can't give us what he don't have. Come on, talk to me. Amen. He's good. He's always good. And he's the Lord, and he changes not. Amen? It's religion that comes up with all this, could I say, baloney? Because they're trying to explain something they didn't look in the Bible to find out. Amen. Well, I'm digressing already. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Say, I'm in church. He's got something for me. I'm going to get it, right, Chelsea? I'm going to get it. Woo! Amen. How many of you know that in life we have what they call relationships? Ooh, what a good subject, relationships. Amen. Now, I know you guys look at Mara and I and you go, I'll be a little facetious here, but you're looking at us, you go, oh, they have the perfect marriage. Not. There's no way it could be perfect because I'm involved in that relationship. That which is imperfect can't have perfection. But we have a successful marriage because we work at our relationship. That sounded really good. Say, Pastor and Pastor Marianne, they have a good marriage relationship because they work at it. And usually it's me doing most of the work because I make the most mistakes, right? But there's only one way to have agreement. Is that you both have to, what? Compromise and choose to agree. And so that's the key to a relationship, is pursuing agreement. Pursuing that harmony. Pulling in the same direction. Amen? Now, did you ever notice that when we start talking about things close to the heart, it really gets quiet? And I'm not even talking about marriage this morning. I just thought I'd throw that out there. So you can all relax now. Right? How many of you know that we have to work at our relationship with God? You know, there's too many of us Christians out there. Oh, by the way, how you doing out there? Glad to have you. Glad you're here with us this morning. I trust you got your Bibles open. What about that pen and pencil? I mean, actually, God could actually say something to you. And you just might want to write that down so you don't forget it. So, glad you're here. He's got something for each one of us, but we got to grab it. Amen? You know, there's a lot of believers that go through life and they've got their ticket. They've got their ticket to heaven. You know, they've received Jesus. They're on their way. And they think that everything between them and God is fixed and secure. And relationally speaking, it is. Right? I mean, those of us that have been blessed to have children, you know, that will always be our child, or they will always be our children. They could go out and rob a 7-Eleven. Guess what? It's still my son. That's still my daughter. Nothing happened to that relationship. But how do you know that the fellowship can kind of wane a little bit? You rob a 7-Eleven, we're not really in good fellowship right now. Yeah, you're still my kid, but guess what? We ain't happy. And so, yes, our relationship with the Father God through Jesus Christ is established. You are a child of God, and that's not going to change through behavior. But how many of you know our fellowship with God isn't always where it needs to be? We're approaching now some good preaching for all of us, right? Are you and I mindful of our current relationship, fellowship with God? Do we have a clear conscience towards Him? It's interesting that there's only one person that the Bible tells you and I that we're allowed to judge. Anybody know who that person is? Ourselves. And so you and I have to get into the habit of doing what I would call a self-evaluation. And He needs to be a part of that. How am I measuring up, Lord? There's some things I need to adjust, things I need to change, things I need to lay down, things I need to pick up. is that that is an opportunity at the communion table to examine ourselves. In fact, he's saying that's how you properly partake of communion. Evaluate. Examine. See where we're, where we are with him. Are we still following him, or do we kind of go off down this little rabbit trail over here? Amen. And so this morning, we advertise this as a communion service, so we're going to take communion. But there's a purpose behind communion, and it's up to you and I to receive that purpose he has for us. How many of you are ready for that? One, two, three, four. Mama, are you ready for this? You birthday girl tomorrow, 93 years old.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. She's with us this morning. Glory to God. So let's get into the Word. Let's go on over to Luke chapter 22, verse 19. What version am I using? Oh, the Christian Standard. This is probably going to come up with King James this morning. Understand that there are two symbols. There's two natural substances that represent that which is spiritual. Many times Jesus and the Word of God will use natural examples to explain to us or to understand what is going in the spiritual realm. And so understand that there are two symbols or two things that are representing a spiritual substance that communion represents. Here's the first one in Luke 22:19. Did you guys pray yet? Remind me later to pray. All right, so in Luke 22:19, it says that Jesus did what? He took bread. That's the first symbol of communion. Bread. What in the world is that? Well, he took that bread, he gave thanks for the bread, he broke the bread, gave it to each one of them and said, this bread represents my body. So this is the body of the Lord. And then he goes on to say, I want you to do this. One translation says, as often as you do this. Meaning that this is something that you and I could do every day if we wanted. And just so that you know that you don't need a hired gun to serve you communion that has a fancy robe and hat on. This is sitting down with your Savior at his communion table that he's afforded you and I, and through him you approach God the Father. You don't need, Jesus is the mediator, not a man. Hallelujah. And the only reason I'm saying that is because I was trained that us so-called believers aren't qualified to take communion on our own. It's not so. I said it's not so. He says, do this, take this bread, do this in remembrance of me. In remembrance of who? Me or Jesus. Well, what do you mean doing it in remembrance of him? Well, one aspect of remembering him at the communion table is to believe what he's provided for you through this table. I'm taking this communion because I'm going to access, I'm going to receive what this bread represents for me. We don't do it as a religious act. We don't do it to get brownie points. We're there to receive something. That's why we do it in remembrance of what he's provided. And so he's given us the bread. What else did he give us? What's the other symbol? Luke 22:20. In the same way. So he's now going to serve them in the same way he just served the bread. He says, in the same way he also took the cup. The cup. Now, why does it say the cup? Why doesn't it say the wine? juice. It's interesting. What the Israelites would do is they knew that the Messiah was coming. And so they had ceremonies that they would sit and commune with God. And on that table was the cup that represented the Messiah. And nobody drank from that cup. Why? It was the cup of the Messiah. And so every time they sat down at that table, here's this cup representing he that was to come to deliver them and save them, the Messiah. So at the Lord's Supper, that cup was there. And guess who drank of it that night? Jesus. So when we say this cup, we're talking about the cup of the Messiah. The one that was foretold who would bear the sin of the world. So we call it the cup, or we could say this morning, the cup of the Messiah. Now look here. This cup. See, he's at the table pointing to it, saying, this cup. It's the cup of the new covenant. Sometimes I think we grasp it a little bit more if we say the new relationship. Relationship. You see, we have relationship with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We're family. Amen? That we've been born into. He says that this cup represents the new relationship that's now being established by the blood of Jesus. Now, growing up in the denominational church, I don't know, somehow I couldn't relate to blood. Am I the only one? Why do we got to talk about blood? Why do I got to drink blood? Or what represents blood? Couldn't it be pop or something? Right? Or a frappuccino? Well, we're not going to talk much about it, but just understand that the blood of God, this is why the Messiah had to be God in flesh, and this is why we couldn't save ourselves, is because we needed something to pay for our sin condition. And I want you to see blood as the currency of heaven. It's not the currency of earth, nothing of this earth has purchased our salvation. It was the currency or the life of God that was in the blood of Jesus. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. So understand that as we're taking this cup, it was the blood that purchased our eternal salvation. Amen? All right. I want to give you a definition of communion because it seems that not everybody can identify with it. I think, well, we won't talk about why. But I want to give you a definition of what I see communion, how it benefits us, what's its value. Why did he want us to do it as often as we do it? Communion is a point of contact. A point of contact to release our faith. A point of contact to receive personally what Jesus has purchased for us. See, nobody, well, I guess I can't say it that definite, but let's say most people don't go to a grocery store and run the cart up and down the aisles, doesn't put anything in it, and then just leaves the store with nothing. Father, help us, Jesus. Help us to see. Help us to embrace. Help us to receive. In Jesus' name, amen. No, you go to that grocery store on purpose. You know what you need, and you go and get it, and you come home with it. Amen? That's how communion is. I took communion for 24 years and left the grocery store with an empty cart. Hello? And that's what millions and millions and millions of believers are doing every time they take communion, because they don't know how, they don't know what they've been given, and they don't know how to receive it. Anybody want to put something in the cart this morning? You want to take something home with you today? I know I need to. Amen? All right. What does the Lord's body provide for us? Well, understand that it has purchased healing and well-being for our physical body. And as well as our mind and emotions. Actually, I dare say that his body was broken to supply everything that we would need in the seen realm. He became poor on the cross so that we could have an overflowing supply. He bared the fruit of that sin condition, of which sickness is one, poverty is one, hopelessness is another. Anything that we need, it was bared away through the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 2:24 says, his own self bared our sins, that sin condition, in his own body on the cross. That we who were lost and trapped, who were dead in our sins, should live unto righteousness, and with his stripes we were what? Healed. Now don't let religious people, you know, throw you a curve and tell you, well, this is talking about spiritual healing. It's impossible to be healed spiritually. You've got to be resurrected. You've got to be born again. No, this is talking about the ills of the body. Amen? So at the communion table, I can receive healing for my body. I can receive healing for my mind. Now see, this has been hands off for a lot of years in Christendom. But if God can heal our physical body, he can heal our mind and mental condition. Hey, January 14th, I got a concussion, brain damage from a car accident. You don't think I'm not appropriating the healing power from my mind? I don't want to just be healed in my body. I want to be healed in my mind as well. And we can get it at his table. If we dare believe and receive. We talked already about the blood. His blood purchased redemption for the entire human race of every generation. God says, the world. For God so loved the world. He wasn't talking about the world per se in that moment. He was talking about everyone of the world, regardless of when they were born. That blood has purchased redemption for each one of us. Look here in Colossians 1:14. It says, in whom, Colossians 1:14 says, in whom, and that That's who you are right now. You're in Him. You're a part of Him. You're a part of His spiritual body. You can't be separated from Him because you're now a part of Him. You're in Him. Just like my finger is part of this physical body. I don't take it off at night and put it by the light stand, right? It's always attached to this because this is the life source that keeps it alive and functional. Well, you're a part of Christ. You can't be separated from Him. That's why the Bible says that nothing can separate us from the love of God, because we're an actual part of Him. Amen. That kind of helps me. Hallelujah. So it's in Him, in Jesus, we have. It doesn't say gonna have. Doesn't say if you're good enough. Doesn't say, well, you never know. It says we have. Everybody say we have. Well, what do you have? Redemption. That's that act of deliverance from darkness that was purchased by His blood. We have redemption. How? Through His currency. His blood. And then it also singles out and encompasses even the forgiveness of sins. So it's the blood of Jesus that purchased our redemption. And notice that you see these two together. You see the blood and forgiveness together. For me, communion is an opportunity for me to get those things that I've missed the mark on. To get those removed from my life. Because it's things that we do wrong are hindrances. Because we have the remembrance of what we've done wrong. And then that lowers our esteem and our standing with God, and it pushes us away from Him. We've got millions of Christians today that are not in church because they're not comfortable with a relationship with Him to be in this kind of a setting. Well, that's what the blood's for. I said, that's what the blood's for. And that's one place, the communion table, that we can get set free. Hallelujah. Going over to Revelation. Revelation chapter 1. How many of you guys like these new cards we got for the church? They're pretty cool, huh? Take a handful of them, please, when you leave, because I want to order more. It was just so much fun to order these and to have some guy help me to design them. I want you to pass them out. To who? Well, be led by the Spirit. Somebody catches your eye. You don't know why. Oh, hey, you want a card? This is where I go to church. This church is awesome. Remember, you do it by faith. Only Sharon got that one. Really, these cards are meant to pass out. We also want them to know that they have a place that they can get help through lending hands. And that's really what, the Lord wants us to do, is to reach out to those in need. Amen? And represent Him in doing it. So please take some cards. They're out on that little table out there in the foyer. If we run out, tell Pastor Marianne. She's got a whole box full of these. And so let's get rid of them as fast as we can so I can order some more. Amen? Praise the Lord. Where were we? Huh? Where were we? See, I'm glad you know where we're going, because I'm, because we're still in Colossians up here. Relation 1:4. Love you, Vince. All right. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from Him which is and which was which is to come. That's your Jesus. And from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, who is the first begotten or the firstborn of the dead, who is the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us. Now we read all that to see that. He did what? He washed us. From what? From my sins. How? In his own blood. Now, people don't like preachers saying this, but it's absolutely the truth. I don't care what a person has done. The blood of Jesus is able to remove that sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You think of the worst person in the world. If that person would come to the Lord and seek forgiveness through Jesus Christ, there'd be no question that he would forgive them. If that was not true, then right now no one would be saved. Because we didn't receive salvation just because of bad behavior. We received salvation because we were sin. We had a sin condition. We were dead in our trespasses and sins, and we were separated from God. We were in a place that was completely away from him. And he didn't think about whether to save you. He didn't, you know, roll dice to see if you should be saved. He didn't go, how am I feeling about this guy right now? No, because he already had sent his son for you and I. It's already been a foregone conclusion. In an instant, when you call upon his name, you are saved. Can anybody say hallelujah right now? Can you say hallelujah right now? Glory. So this morning, we're going to talk about receiving forgiveness at his table. I got a whole other page of notes, but you don't need it. You don't need to hear all this because you already know what he's done for you. And it's not a matter of getting all this information. What it is about is saying, hey, I got something that's blocking my fellowship with God, and I'm going to let him remove it from my life. And that obstacle will be removed, and I'll be in perfect standing with him. Not because of me and you, but because of what Jesus did. We're just simply accepting, receiving, taking it because he gave it to us freely. Amen? So we talked about examining ourselves. But let a man, a human being, let him examine himself. And I encourage you guys watching out there, this encompasses you as well. This is an opportunity afforded to you as well. Not just us here looking all perky and everything. Do you have a rub with the Lord? Is there something you thought he should have done but didn't? Don't get quiet on me. This is no time to get quiet. Because everybody's going to be looking at you. Oh, he's talking to that person. But if you're all smiling, going, yeah, glory to God, preach it, brother, we'll never suspect you. Yeah. see how some of the whiteness of the page is kind of discolored? Did you see that? Well, that means my greasy fingers have been here a while. Okay? Now, let me show you where, I'm going to show you this page over here at 1 John 1:9. I know you all thought I was perfect. Why are you laughing? I want you to see how soiled it is right here. That's because I've been to this page a time or two. And I had to go to the Lord in humility and man up and say, hey, I missed it here. And I know it was wrong. I did it anyway. But I choose to turn from it. That's what repent is. I choose to turn from it and to grow out of that behavior. See, sin doesn't free you in terms of now you won't do it anymore. It gives you the opportunity to start growing so you grow out of that sin. Right? Like all three of my children had this dirty, dirty habit of soiling their diapers. We kept waiting for the light to come on, that white thing in that little small room, that's where you deposit that, not in your diaper. Well, they had to grow out of that. Some sooner than others. Won't mention any names. Like my grandson. Dare I say how old he was when he finally figured out what that white thing was in the bathroom? And so, when we got something that's reoccurring that we know is wrong, it's a growth issue. I'm still a baby in that area, and I need to grow up. And so I have to make the effort to grow in that area. So here we are, we're examining ourselves. There's some things that we know that we need to get removed by the blood of Jesus, right? Notice it says, if you don't mind me making this personal, when I confess my sins. Now you understand this is talking about something that's happening between you and the Lord. Remember, Jesus is the mediator. He's the go-between, not some guy with a fancy hat. All right? God bless all those guys, but the Bible tells us there's one mediator between God and man, the man, Jesus Christ. I don't need to know anything other than that. Hallelujah. Remember, we have sonship. We have daughtership, right? We are a child of God. And he's our daddy, and we can go to him through Jesus Christ. So I confess my sins. I man up and own my sin. I own my mistakes. I'm declaring that that was wrong, and I should not have done it. And since we're on the subject, you have these people that say, well, you can wear out God's forgiveness. What? Are you kidding me? Don't you know who God is? He's the same yesterday and today. Yeah, but what if I've done that 1,000 times before? Well, welcome to the club. Hello? He don't care if it's the 1,000th time, the 2,000th time, because he wants you by his side. And that thorn, that behavior that you know is wrong, is pushing you away from him, and that's not why he gave us Jesus. He gave us Jesus so we could be with him, heart to heart, 24/7, 365. Amen? So when I own up, when I step up, that's when he steps up. Understand that God has to be reactionary in our life, because you have a will, you have a choice, and he'll never violate it. So he's always waiting. then he is what? Faithful. And he is just. He is righteous to do what? To forgive us. There's no strings attached. I said there's no strings attached. There's no strings attached. You own it, repent from it, ask him to forgive you, bam. He forgives us from what? All our sins. It's plural. But not only that, I mean, that's good, right? Now you understand that he throws those sins that we give him through his forgiveness, he throws them to the bottom of the sea. Or to say, he erases them. He removes them. He'll never bring them up to you again. Yeah, but what happens when I keep thinking about what I did? Well, that's that bonehead, the devil. He's always reminding us of our mistakes. That's what he do. He's the condemner. He's the accuser. But you and I have to be more Bible smart than that, so we recognize, well, that's just the enemy. And we just say, well, yeah, I did do that, but I asked for forgiveness, and I'm clean, and I'm white as the, you know, sun reflecting off the snow. And while you're there talking to him, you ought to remind him of what his future is. Hey, I understand you're going to the lake of fire soon. I hope you got your suntan lotion. Because that's where he's going. And he's defeated anyway. Amen? To cleanse you from what? All unrighteousness. Ready to get into this? Let's go ahead and serve the communion symbols. We have someone doing that this morning. I really appreciate your help. You're going to be given the opportunity to have the bread, which is a oyster cracker, right? We don't have to have something fancy, right? I used a piece of paper once for the bread. Remember, it's a symbol. I just need to mix faith with what it represents. And you're also going to get the cup. There's some very broken for me. And through your broken body, you took my sickness. You took my mental condition. You took my poverty. You took all my lack. And as I receive this now, I do it by faith. And I believe that once it touches my lips and my tongue, I say, by his stripes, I was healed. I was healed. Say, I receive it now. In Jesus' name.
Say, I believe I receive it. I've got my healing now. I got my blessing now. Hallelujah. See, when you believe something, there has to be an expression of that belief. Thanksgiving is one of the best ways to do that. Don't wait to feel something. Don't wait to see something. Let your mouth sing praises because you believe. You got it. All right. Here's the cup of the Messiah. This juice represents a heavenly currency that's paid your debt and my debt in full. In full. Now, did you locate something that you need to give the Lord in the way of repentance? Did you find something that you know that you need to work on and grow in, but you want to get forgiven and washed? Is there anyone like that here this morning? Here I am. Here I am. Here I am. Now this cup isn't going to cover what we did. It's going to remove it. As if it never happened. Are you getting that? Are you getting that? And once you take this by faith, there's no way you can ever be any closer to the Lord than in that moment. You can grow more, but as your relationship and fellowship with him, you can't get any closer to him. Why? Because of the cup of the Messiah. You've accessed that which removes sin and cleanses us. So say, I have examined myself. I now repent. I now turn my back on those things I did wrong. And I receive forgiveness now. And as I partake of this cup, I believe my sin is removed. And I am forgiven. And I'm now cleansed and made whole with my Father God through the blood of Jesus. I receive it now. Take it. Hallelujah. 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 I'm forgiven. I am cleansed. I am righteous. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Scripture that says that Jesus left the 99. You came into my heart. And now I'm a new creature. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's raise our hands and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Today.
We just witnessed. Did you see what we just witnessed? Three people passed from death unto life. And that's the greater works of Jesus. Because not one person was born again in his earthly ministry. But he gave us his body the responsibility to get the people saved. That's the greater works of Jesus. We just saw the greater works. You don't look happy. I said, that was the greater works that Jesus told us to do. Don't you think he's smiling? Amen. Father, thank you for giving us opportunity to share your love, to share your salvation. I thank you that everyone here under the sound of my voice is now free at the communion table. And Lord, we claim good fellowship as we eat lunch today. I speak over the food and I declare you good for the body. Thank you, Lord, for all those that gave of their own resources to bring their food here. May they receive a blessing. So we say the food now is blessed and sanctified and good to the body, and we will enjoy great fellowship in Jesus' name. Everybody said, hey! Love that enthusiasm. You're the one. You're the one.